Hi, imagine a scenario where your company has just successfully defended a crucial audit. No adverse observations, barring a few minor ones and some suggestions. Everybody in the company is elated and expecting promotions and pay hike, etc. The core management has deputed the marketing team to niche markets to convince the customer that approval is round the corner. A mail from regulatory agency dropped bombshell that it is withholding the approval for lack of control of benzene and carbon tetrachloride in finished good. The cryptic and ominous wordings of the mail reads like this, quote, since in final step of crystallization, your firm has used cyclohexane where benzene is a potential impurity in cyclohexane. Additionally, in N-2 step, the intermediate is further purified by slurry washing with methylene chloride and carbon tetrachloride is one of the impurity in commercial supplies. Since both of these solvents are class 1, therefore their control in final stage need to be demonstrated through a validated procedure. Whole process validation and related exercise are in limbo now. The euphoria of successful audit is evaporated and a gloomy pall descended over the company as the approval is now at least a year away. This is a common scenario in many pharmaceutical firms where people work enthusiastically but without applying scientific knowledge. Hello and welcome to my channel. I am Arvind Mittal. I am a pharma auditor and consultant. Thank you for watching this video. I am looking forward to interact with you in future also. Regulatory, analytical research, and quality control are my favorite areas. In my channel, you will find most authentic information of pharmaceutical industry. The inside stories, though anonymous, shall be drawn from real, lively, and challenging life of pharmaceutical industry. If you have not subscribed my channel so far, please do so right now by pressing subscribe button and press the bell icon so that you get an immediate notification of my new video. So we are talking about regulatory surprises residual solvents can throw before us. In addition to cyclohexane, there are several other solvents which may contain benzene as contaminant. Similarly, carbon tetrachloride is another class 1 solvent which requires attention if we are using dichloromethane and chloroform in manufacturing process. What are the sources of these two class 1 solvent in pharmaceutical even if they are not used in manufacturing process? This is the topic we are going to take up today. Let us see what are those solvents and what are the requirements. So here is a list of solvents along with their ICH limits which must be investigated for benzene and carbon tetrachloride. These are methanol, ethanol, acetone, cyclohexane, toluene. And for carbon tetrachloride, the solvents are methylene dichloride and chloroform. Let us take them one by one and see what are the sources of these two class 1 solvents in commercial supplies of the mentioned solvents. But before that, we shall see the regulatory requirements. Chapter 467 of United States Pharmacopoeia talks about solvents which are likely to be present or LTBP solvent, even if they are not part of manufacturing process. More specifically, it talks about class 1 solvents like benzene and carbon tetrachloride owing to their high toxicity and carcinogenicity. USP enjoins upon the manufacturer to investigate all possible sources of class 1 solvent in pharmaceuticals. In marketing application, this information should be included in section 3.2.S.2.3 if you are dealing with drug substances, in section 3.2.P.4 for excipient, and in section 3.2.P.5 P.5 for drug products of ECTD. Second thing which USP emphasizes, that use of state-of-art instruments while detecting these two solvents. The pharmaceutical limit of benzene and carbon tetrachloride are 2 and 4 ppm respectively, and their responses in GC headspace analysis are not satisfactory. For carbon tetrachloride, electron capture detector should invariably be used. Besides FID and ECD, GCMS is also suitable for this purpose. When we talk about satisfactory responses, it means that limit of quantitation should at least be 50% of the limit of solvent, and more preferably 25% of the limit. Therefore, our method should be able to quantitate preferably 0.5 ppm benzene and 1 ppm carbon tetrachloride respectively. The third point is, if somehow a manufacturer fails to investigate the sources of class 1 solvent, then their presence should be screened either in raw material state, intermediate or final stage, or at all the levels. Before discussing probable source, let us see why benzene and carbon tetrachloride are so peculiar. Why they get concentrated in pharmaceuticals? The answer lies in their non-polarity and spatial configuration. Benzene molecule is completely flat and it can stack itself in the interstitial space of crystal lattice. Similarly, due to non-polarity of carbon tetrachloride, its molecule can position themselves easily in the interstitial space of crystal lattice. Once benzene and carbon tetrachloride are trapped inside the crystal, then it becomes nearly impossible to remove them by drying. At times, even VTD is unable to remove them. The only option left is redissolution and recrystallization, which generally comes with yield loss and cost escalation. Trapping of solvent in crystal lattice is a common and challenging phenomenon in pharmaceutical industry. Besides benzene and carbon tetrachloride, many other non-polar solvents like hexane, heptane, dichloromethane, and chloroform are known to trap in crystal lattice. Now, let us first discuss methanol. Methanol is commercially produced from synthesis gas, which is a mixture of carbon monoxide and hydrogen. Synthesis gas is obtained by cracking of woods, agriculture waste like crop stubbles, and coal. All these inputs are good source of BTX, that is benzene, toluene, and xylene. This is number one source. Second source. When synthesis gas is catalytically converted into methanol, along with water, other higher alcohol, alkene, alkanes, and aromatic compounds are formed. The crude yield of methanol is 85%, which is purified either by distillation or by fractional distillation. Some manufacturers, especially in Southeast Asia and China, save energy and do not go for fractional distillation. Boiling point of methanol benzene azeotrope is 58 degrees centigrade, whereas boiling point of methanol is 64.7 degrees centigrade. Some of the benzene can be introduced here. However, the biggest source is ethanol water benzene azeotrope formed during catalytic conversion and whose boiling point is 64.9 degrees centigrade. The boiling point of methanol is 64.7 degrees centigrade. Difference of 0.2 centigrade makes it very, very difficult to separate methanol with this ternary azeotrope even by fractional distillation. We shall see the phase diagram of ethanol water benzene azeotrope later on. Even though we are talking about 0.005 to 0.01% level, this will come to 50 to 100 ppm of benzene, which is 25 to 50 times of limit of benzene in pharmaceuticals. In my previous video, I have explained conversion of percentage to ppm and vice versa, and shall not repeat it again. As an analytical chemist, you should always be skeptic about the raw material which you are receiving. Or Skepticism is the best weapon of an analytical chemist. If a manufacturer says that his commercial methanol is 99.8%, then don't become happy and complacent. You must ask, what is 0.2% or 2000 ppm? It is general practice in QC department that chemists are asked to omit peaks which are less than or equal to 0.02% or 200 ppm. Therefore, an impurity with a level of 0.005 to 0.01 is easily overlooked. Similarly, a synthetic chemist must be aware that he may be working with several parts per million of benzene. Ethanol. Major chunk of ethanol in world is produced by fermentation of molasses, though a small portion is produced by ethylene hydration. For most industrial uses, ethanol must be purified. Fractional distillation at atmospheric pressure can concentrate ethanol to 95.6% by weight. 4.4% is water. This mixture is an azeotrope with a boiling point of 78.2 degrees centigrade and cannot be further purified by distillation. Addition of an entraining agent such as benzene, cyclohexane, or heptane allows formation of a new ternary azeotrope comprising the ethanol, water, and the entraining agent. The lower boiling ternary azeotrope is removed preferentially, leading to water-free ethanol. Generally, a small part of benzene is added as entraining agent. Benzene, ethanol, and water forms a ternary azeotrope with a boiling point of 64.9 degrees centigrade. In this regard, it would be pertinent here to look at phase diagram of benzene, ethanol, water, ternary azeotropic distillation. At the corner of the triangles are ethanol, benzene, and water, with boiling point of 78.3 degrees centigrade, 80.1 degrees centigrade, and 100 degrees centigrade respectively. Benzene also forms binary azeotrope with ethanol and water, a property which makes it favorable over cyclohexane and other entraining agents. Ethanol-water binary azeotrope has boiling point 78.2 degrees centigrade. This is 78.2 degrees centigrade, whereas pure ethanol's boiling point is 78.3 degrees centigrade. When benzene is added, the ternary azeotrope distills at 64.9 degrees centigrade. This is the boiling point of ternary azeotrope, 64.9 degrees centigrade, which is far below the boiling point of ethanol. At this stage, most of the water is distilled off. At 68.2 degrees centigrade, binary azeotrope of ethanol benzene is distilled off, and at 69.3 degrees centigrade, binary azeotrope of benzene water is distilled off. The next stage is 78.3 degrees centigrade. This is the next stage. This is the first distillation point. This is the second distillation point. This is the third one. And fourth is the distillation of pure ethanol. All of the water is essentially extracted in two-stage azeotropic distillation. However, the bottom line of such distillation is anhydrous ethanol with several hundred ppm of residual benzene. Therefore, an analytical chemist and a synthetic chemist must be aware if ethanol is being used in the process, then benzene must be controlled in finished products. Then acetone. Approximately 83% of acetone is produced via cumene process. Commercial production of cumene is by Friedel-Crafts alkylation of benzene with propylene. Cumene is then oxidized by air to produce phenol and acetone. As a result, acetone production is tied to phenol production. The separation of benzene, boiling point 80.1 degrees centigrade, from acetone, boiling point 56.2 degrees centigrade, would appear to be readily accomplished by rectification. The boiling point difference of 23.9 degrees centigrade appears to be sufficient In practice, it is found, however, that getting the last traces of benzene out of acetone is difficult by rectification because of closeness of their vapor pressure. Acetone can be removed from benzene by ternary azeotropic distillation using aromatic hydrocarbons like toluene, ethyl benzene, and mesityline. Nevertheless, pure acetone is left with several parts per million of benzene. Second solvent is cyclohexane. Cyclohexane is mainly produced by catalytic hydrogenation of benzene. Removal of unreacted benzene from product stream is very important in this process. Unlike benzene, cyclohexane is not found in natural sources such as coal or wood. Separation of benzene and cyclohexane is one of the most challenging processes in chemical industry. On account of only 0.6 degree difference of boiling point of the two components, separation of benzene and cyclohexane is difficult by conventional distillation process because these components form close boiling point mixture at entire range of their composition. Azeotropic distillation and extractive distillation are accompanied by high capital and operative cost and also are complex processes in nature. Membrane pervaporation is viable alternative to conventional technique both from economical and technical point of view. However, cyclohexane is laced with several ppm of benzene. We shall see it in the next slide. This is a typical gas chromatographic trace of cyclohexane. The best commercial supply of cyclohexane have 0.03 to 0.05% benzene. In ppm terms, level of benzene is 300 to 500 ppm. Compare this level with permissible level of benzene in pharmaceuticals. Next is toluene. Toluene is produced by BTX process. BTX production is based on recovery of aromatics derived from catalytic reforming of naphtha in a petroleum refinery. Catalytic reforming usually utilizes a feedstock naphtha that contains non-aromatic hydrocarbons with 6 to 12 carbon atoms and typically produce a reformate product containing C6 to C8 aromatics, benzene, toluene, and xylene, as well as paraffins and heavier aromatics containing 9 to 12 carbon atoms. As you can see, that benzene is part of commercial supplies of toluene. So this is a typical chromatogram. This is a typical chromatogram of toluene, and you can see the peak of benzene. Now, last one is dichloromethane and chloroform. Dichloromethane and chloroform are produced by treating either chloromethane or methane with chlorine gas at 400 to 500 degrees centigrade. At these temperatures, both methane and chloromethane undergo a series of reactions producing progressively more chlorinated products. The output of these processes is mixture of chloromethane, dichloromethane, chloroform, and carbon tetrachloride, as well as hydrogen chloride as a byproduct. These compounds are separated by distillation. Like benzene, chlorinated solvents also have tendency to get trapped inside the crystal lattice of the substance. Gas chromatographers in pharmaceutical industry must have seen a bunch of peak around dichloromethane and chloroform. What are those compounds? Don't overlook them. European Pharmacopoeia monograph for methylene chloride lists carbon tetrachloride as EP impurity A. So what is the way out? Should you stop using all these solvents? No, this is not feasible. Instead, you should show conclusively through process validation that your process is capable to control LTBT solvents. This should be a part of 3.2.S.2.3 and 3.2.S.2.4 of ECTD, that is control of materials and control of critical step and intermediates. Even if your process is able to control class 1 solvent, it is mandatory to show their control in finished product. Unlike class 2 and class C solvent, you can't omit their testing in finished product after controlling those at 10% of their limit. Nowadays, many small and medium pharmaceutical firms aspire to attain regulatory approvals and tap niche markets overseas. A regulatory approval not only provides an opportunity to go global, but also instills confidence in customers' mind. While working in a regulated environment, even a newly inducted chemist should be aware of repercussions of using a solvent in the manufacturing process. Apart from awareness, it is now mandatory to investigate traces of all solvents in drug substances, product, and excipient. With this, we have come to an end of Residual Solvents Part 2. In Part 3, I shall take up those solvents that are not grouped under Class 1, 2, or 3. These solvents are tagged as solvents with no adequate toxicological data. We shall learn how to calculate their levels in pharmaceuticals, what strategies are available with us to deal with such solvents, and how can we fine-tune our marketing application. Till then, goodbye and keep watching.